Okay, so as our coordinator, Dr. Pradhan sir says, about some important key points about OTAL FDP, please follow those important points throughout the FDP. During the session, a link will be provided in your chat box for the attendance of participants through Google form. Please fill the form and submit for your successful attendance, as 80% attendance is mandatory for participants. And if you have any question during the presentation, please type them in chat box. I will bring them after presentation when we will have time for questionnaires. To keep the quality of sound, please everyone mute your phone and system. Okay, so for today's, our speaker is, at the outset, in my privilege, it is my privilege to invite our first research person of day one, AICT OTAL FDP, Dr. Umakant Subbudhi sir. Dr. Umakant Subbudhi sir is a senior scientist at CSIR Institute of Mineral and Materials Technology. He is also assistant professor at Academy of Science and Innovative Research. He has published 32 papers in international journals of high impact. His work has received more than 650 citations with H index 14. He has delivered a number of invited talks at various institutes. He has also bagged a several awards, which includes Hor Gobindo Khorana Innovative Young Biotechnologist Award, Young Scientist Award from CSIR, Odisha Young Scientist Award, and many more. He has research experience more than 15 years and teaching experience more than 12 years. He is the reviewer of various international journals like Chemical Society Review, Chemical Communication, Nanoscale, Nature Scientific Reports, J Nanoparticle Reports, Neuroendocrinology, Journal of Nanomaterials, Molecular Biology Reports. He is a member of various academic and scientific associations. He has been pursuing his research activity in the field of basic as well as applied research. In particular, DNA, nanostructure, DNA expression, breast cancer, etc. So with this high altitude of achievement, sir, please start your session. Sir, for now, I am making you as host for this program, so you can share your presentation. Over to you, sir. Thank you, sir, please. Okay, participants, just hold on for some time as sir is joining for some technical issue. It is not able to connect for Subbudhi sir. Just have patience.
Am I audible? You please unmute and tell.
Yes, sir, audible.
And also enable means, okay, and enable me to share my screen, please.
Sir, you are now host for the session. You can share your screen here. Huh? Now you are the host of the session.
But it is showing host disabled participant screen sharing. So just make sure that my name Sai Ramakrishna is on, you know, enabled for sharing the screen, please.
Sir, just now you can try. We gave the host option to you. So you can share here, sir. Share
right, correct. Yeah. So is it visible now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is visible now.
One minute. Okay, so we'll continue. Thank you for a nice word of introduction. It's really a wonderful occasion to have a close interaction with the participant under this Atal Faculty Development Program. I'm really thankful to Dr. Pradhan for his invitation, and also I congratulate all the organizing committee members for organizing such wonderful program for the faculty development. And I welcome all the participants for this today's lecture. And as you know, he was introduced that I work on CSIR Institute of Minerals and Materials Technology in Bhubaneswar. Those they have been to our institute, they might have seen. So this is the main building of our institute, and we have many discipline covering from engineering as well as basic science, working on minerals and materials. We have a large group of people working on materials, particularly nanomaterials, and our group work on nanomaterials based upon DNA. And it will be very apt to put the nucleic acid based nanotherapeutics as the title under the nanomaterials, which we do last 10 years. So this is how we'll start with. And today is very memorable day, the 7th July. As you know, the three scientists, Wilmot, who supervised the cloning in Dolly, and Maria Stevens, who first time mentioned that the sex determination is dependent upon the X chromosome, and Camillo Golgi, who discovered the Golgi body or the Golgi complex. 7th July is the birthday for all of them. So it's really nice to give a lecture on this day. And not only that, the first successful thumb implantation happened today. Isaac Newton received his degree from Trinity College London on this day. And also Michael Faraday noticed the river pollution, particularly River Thames. So as we know, these nanomaterials are used for many other applications and for the, solving the pollution problem. So long back, Faraday noticed such pollution in the river, and today we have many pollutions in the river in Endway as well. So those, their work on the pollution and the remediation using nanomaterials, that is very, very useful. And today I'll be talking on the discovery of the DNA and DNA nanotechnology. Being a DNA, it's a 2 nanometer structured nanomaterial, and how we design the oligos, prepare the monomeric structure, more polymeric structure, and its applications for nanotherapeutics, particularly in cancer. As you move around in your own community, you find some climber, through support, they move around. And all through, you'll find a right-handed structure, whether it is electric pole or a pillar or a tree, doesn't matter. Even I noticed once a carrot, it has a right-handed structure. It's not surprising that our earth rotates in the right-handed manner. And many times I'm surprised what makes all these, plants, climbers, they move in that direction, follow the same pattern of the earth. And it'll be appreciate that our own DNA, which is there in the nucleus, there is also a right-handed structure. And this molecule, particularly the DNA, is very, very, robust, which carries the information for everyone, for all the human beings, plants, animals, bacteria, virus, everything. And that is the blueprint of life. The biological ability to store the genetic information, the chemical stability, the physical diversity, and the mathematical simplicity. The 4 nucleotides A, T, G, C, or you call adenine, guanine, cytosine, and thymine, enable the DNA as the chosen material for the biological field of research. And for the first time, since we moved towards the DNA nanotechnology, or many of us will just review, and throughout the lecture you'll find being a faculty development program, we all through interact with the students, and the teacher student relationship reflected in science. That's how we'll find many occasions in the during lectures. That's how we have to carry. Secondly, how the field genes, you know, evolved with time, and currently what is the status of DNA nanotechnology. And long back, when people are unaware of the DNA, so Boveri for the first time mentioned that each chromosome contains only one DNA, and chromosomes are separate and continuous organized structure within the cell, and these chromosomes, in each chromosome we have a long DNA molecule, and any change in such molecule, then you may have carcinogenesis and others. And these chromosomes, in our case, it's 23 pairs, including the X and Y chromosomes, and in each chromosome we have genes, more than 4,000 genes in chromosome 1, and in accordingly in other chromosomes you have several genes. So genes are arranged in the DNA in the form of nucleotides. So it's a random arrangement of nucleotides. We cannot say just random, but you know, someone has arranged really so that they are expressed, they are controlled, they are repressed, they are, you know, upregulated, they are downregulated. That the manner the sequence are arranged, where they interact with the proteins as well as the DNA, makes the, you know, gene or genome to be expressed for the proteome and RNA as well. And if you see the E. coli genome, which is 1 million base pairs, it only takes 20 minutes to replicate itself. And its genome, which is 12 million, 12 times more, it takes 90 minutes to replicate the double prime is that. And all these organisms are used for the model organisms. The fruit fly, Drosophila melanogaster, the genome is 122 million base pair, takes 24 hour time for the division. And in our case, human genome is 3.4 million base pairs, and we have a 24 hours time for its replications. And this is how you see the chromosome. You cannot say the DNA, rather it's a chromosome in the electron microscope. These are nothing free ends. It looks like that, but all through the DNA, it's wrapped by the histone proteins to make the feature of chromosome. And in chromosome, you have only one DNA. The below picture, you'll find the chromosome-like structure. I love this structure because this is a satellite image of our own village, and this looks like a chromosome. And if one can stretch the DNA, as we can isolate the DNA from a single cell, and from the single cell, if the DNA will be elongated, and as you know, it will be 46 number of chromosomes total in one cell, a human cell. And the entire DNA can be 2 meters long. Imagine 2 meters long DNA is packaged inside the nucleus of the individual cell. And if you go on writing the 3.4 billion base pairs in the human genome, if someone writes ATGC, or if you can type ATGC nucleotides or the letters ATGC, but possibly in one A4 size paper, one can write 3,400 nucleotides. Okay, thus to write the entire genome, we need 1 million pages, which is equivalent to 1,000 books having 1,000 pages each. So this is very, very important to understand. Imagine, suppose you have a bookshelf having 100 books. That means of 1,000 pages each. That means you have 110 bookshelf filled with the human genome. And imagine if someone reads the genome. Okay, just to read that, you know, such volumes of books, it takes time. And in 24 hours time, imagine the nano devices, that is proteins, the DNA, which there inside the nucleus, they read, they translate, they transcribe to RNA, translate to the, protein. Such things happen inside the, imagine the shell, a nucleus, okay. So the 10 almirahs containing the 10 or 10 bookshelves having the 1,000 books having 1,000 pages each, that is there inside the single cell, not only that DNA only, there are many proteins, RNA, machineries that is there inside the nucleus, and that, collectively regulate the whole growth and development of any individuals. So, and such DNA was not discovered, before 1969. And to convince the entire world that DNA is the genetic material, it almost took 85 years. It took 85 years. So it started from 1869 by Friedrich Miescher. and then continued research with a gap of 20, 30 years like that, because, you know, that time people are very much aware that possible protein controls everything. There is no concept of DNA. And to prove that DNA is the genetic material, it almost took 85 years. And ultimately, in 1953, Francis Crick, Watson, and Wilkins proposed the model of double helix. And in 62, they got Nobel Prize. That's how we know. So let us briefly go through the individual, how this field started. And as you know, we remember only Watson and Crick for the double helix structure. It's not really the two or the three person scientists. Rather, there are a group of people, in fact, working for the solving the structure of the DNA, possibly the 18, the main group working on the solving the DNA structure in the 85 years time. So, and you'll be appreciate that Frederick Sanger, who is the father of genomics and got Nobel Prize for the structure of insulin as well as sequencing the DNA, he tells that science is not the, like the Olympic Games or something where there is a lot of people all trying to win gold medals. And if you do not get the medal, you are nothing. Really, in science, there are actually a lot of people are working together and contributing to the science, and the science is the important thing, right? So ultimately, so Watson Crick not solved everything, right? With the support of all these people, maybe 100 scientists, okay, or maybe more than that, whatever evidence they took, ultimately they proposed the double helical model. As a result, we get that. Okay, some, you know, noise somehow came in the screen. Somehow I but don't you know, stick to yourself. There is a yellow line. Maybe that is reflected there. Okay, so this in Germany, in the nucleic acid research and the genome research started in Germany, and Germany is also very famous to produce the first few Nobel laureates in chemistry in the lab of Kekulé. So Kekulé was a wonderful scientist who discovered the benzene structure, and because of the benzene, many of the, you know, cyclic compounds evolved later, and all these students got the first series of Nobel Prize from this Kekulé lab. Similarly, the genome research started in Germany in the lab of Scheller, and his student Friedrich Miescher actually isolated the DNA and he named its nucleon from inside the nucleus of the neutrophils. And later to the same group joined Kosel, who isolated and screened and characterized the nucleotides A, T, G, C, and all the students also got Nobel Prize. So we'll go very sincerely all through that. So Friedrich Miescher was the scientist. In fact, he for the first time isolated this unique molecule DNA from the neutrophils, the nucleus of the neutrophils. And like many other students, he was very ambitious to take medical science, and because his father and uncle both are medical doctors, and of course he qualified and selected while studying the medicine. He became suffered from typhoid fever, and that enabled he lost his hearing. So that he thought that, you know, if I'll hear, I would not hear the patients, then I may not be a very good doctor. So let me change my profession and I look to the basic science and the basic research. And that's how he approached Professor Scheller, University of Tübingen, Germany, to continue his research, to initiate his research. And Scheller agreed. And he told a wonderful problem that what you do, you go and collect the bandages, like your clinic from father's or uncle's clinic, you can get the waste bandages. And there, the neutrophil cells are very pretty high because any wound healing process, your neutrophil concentration goes up. And in the neutrophils, the nucleus is lobed nucleus. And we're very much interested what is there inside the nucleus. Particularly, you can easily screen the lobed nucleus of the neutrophils. And he was thoroughly characterizing, daily collecting the bandages and isolating the neutrophils, then nucleus. And from the nucleus, found that there is enough material, and that material is very, very unique. By the time protein is thoroughly characterized, and any protein you name, that must be containing sulfur. And this material, which Miescher identified in the nucleus of the neutrophils found there is no sulfur at all. He was very much excited that anything is possible, that any material is available, and biologists, they are very pretty much sure that all materials contains, all proteins contain sulfur, which is supposed to control the inflammation. But I found something inside the nucleus that is very rich in phosphorus, and there is no sulfur. Incidentally, there is no phosphorus in the protein, and there is no sulfur in the DNA. Okay, so he, for the first time, saw that certainly I have identified something unique molecule, and that he named as nuclein, because he isolated from the nucleus of the neutrophils, and that is rich in phosphorus, and there is no sulfur atom. To celebrate his 100 years, so in Germany, there is another institute in his name, actually established, Friedrich Miescher Institute for Biomedical Science Research. And you'll appreciate many of the modern day techniques are contribution by the Friedrich Miescher Institute, which was established in the 70s. Whether it is discovery of kinase PKB or mammalian target rapamycin, or maybe human growth factor receptor, those are all related to the cancer possibly, and the human dicer, Western blotting technique, green fluorescence protein, and many other like DNA methylation, you know, technique. So these are contributed by Friedrich Miescher Institute for Biomedical Research these days. Then to the cellular lab, Albert Kossel joins. Albert Kossel was very curious to know, to characterize what is there in the nuclein. And he identified the, you know, five important nucleotides, adenine, guanine, cytosine, thymine, and uracil, and two are purines, the adenine and guanine, the other three are pyrimidines. And for characterizing this, the compounds present in the nucleic acid, he received 1910 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine. And of course, in his name also, we have another institute. But even in 1910, people didn't believe that DNA is genetic material. You know, that's where the genesis is. And Friedrich Miescher, you know, Griffith, then, you know, 1928, performed a wonderful experiment. As we know, there are two types of, like, you know, smooth, and those are virulent, and the non-virulent, which is a rough strain of Streptococcus pneumoniae. And these two strains he injected to the mouse. And as usual, the rough strain, which is non-virulent, except for the mouse, which is smooth strain, which is virulent, caused disease, pneumonia, and the mouse dies. So this is a very simple experiment as you understand science. But that experiment is very unique in a sense that he asks that if the heat, by heat kill method, you kill the organism and you lost the protein activity, so that there should be, you know, there should be no disease. So then he heat killed the smooth strain, which is supposed to be virulent, which is supposed to, you know, cause disease, pneumonia. And after killing, he injected the heat killed smooth strain to the mouse and found, yes, as usual, the mouse, you know, lives, there is no problem. But that didn't stop him the experiment. So what he asked now, the non-virulent rough strain and the heat killed smooth strain, he mixed both. And both are supposed not to, you know, cause the disease pneumonia, because both are safe. The non-virulent is safe and the heat killed is also safe. But while mixing both, he observed very, you know, unusual result that the mouse dies. What's the reason? Now he, you know, dissected and cultured the, you know, cells. He found that, yes, there are virulent strains. So how come the virulent strain will come? Because I have not injected this virulent strain. Then he proposed that possibly the heat killed smooth strain had something in it that made the transform the non-virulent to the virulent. And that's what he proposed, the transforming principle. And he was quite confident that certainly it is not the protein, it is something else is there, that is the genetic material. But this experiment, you know, not convinced the scientific community that protein DNA is the genetic material. Because people argue that there are proteins which is heat stable as well, like, you know, TAC polymerase and others, they are stable even in, you know, close to 100 degrees Celsius. So possibly your idea that you have heat killed something and you are proposing that, you know, it is not the protein, it's DNA, or there is a transferring principle, we don't agree. And this, you know, almost took another maybe 15 years and people didn't agree. Then, of course, you know, in 1941, he died. And that time the world was like that, the, you know, protein is the material which is controlling the genetics, not the DNA, right? Now in 44, his very good friend, Griffith's friend is Avery. And Avery, by the time, thought that whatever Griffith was telling possibly right, let me try once again. And in that, you know, if you see from 1920 to 40, it is the time for the enzyme research. And at that time, people had many enzymes, proteinase, RNAs, DNAs. And he took the same experimental setup. And the heat kill material, he again treated with three things. One is RNAs, another is DNAs, another is proteinase. And the idea was very, very clear. If these enzymes are known, the DNA is known to degrade the DNA, RNA is known to degrade the RNA, and protein is known to degrade the protein. If the transforming principle, it could have been protein and RNA, then it will be lost its activity by proteinase and RNA treatment. If it is a DNA, then by treatment of DNA, then it lost its effect. But he found very, very, very clear result that the transforming principle, which is treated with DNAs, lost its efficiency, whereas RNAs and proteinase treated sample, and there is all colony are smooth, there is no rough. So if the control, if you have rough, but it's transformed to the smooth only in the RNAs and proteinase treated sample, that means this experiment thoroughly convinced the people that it is certainly the DNA is the genetic matter, not the RNA. Suddenly, all of scientists working on the protein and other fields, they jump to solve what is there in the DNA and how to solve the structure of the DNA. And Erwin Chergev in 1950, he isolated the DNA all from whatever organisms he found all across, and he isolated the DNA and he characterized the percentage of adenine, guanine, cytosine, thymine as Keller already, the co-cell already identified. These are the four nucleotides present in the DNA. And he noticed very unique thing that the percentage of adenine is always equal to the percentage of thymine. You can just check all my dear teachers, respected teachers, please go through the slide and you'll find, observe, and always the percentage of guanine is always equal to the percentage of thymine, cytosine. Whether it is a human, rat, chicken, octopus, urchin, yeast, E. coli, it doesn't matter. All through, the percentage of adenine is equal to the percentage of thymine, and percentage of guanine is equal to the percentage of cytosine in whatever organisms isolated from virus, from bacteria, from everything. Thus, he proposed a rule that we understand, Chergev's rule, the number of purines is equal to the number of pyrimidines. But very unique figure also, he isolated the DNA from 5X174, which is a sense-single-stranded DNA, like our COVID, the SARS coronavirus, it is a sense RNA, single-stranded RNA. This 5X174 is a single-stranded circular DNA molecule. And there, he found that percentage of adenine is not equal to the percentage of thymine, as well the guanine percentage is not matching to the cytosine, right? That means he proposed, that time, that possibly this organism contains a single stranded DNA. There is no base pairing, there is no match. And that's the very first time that DNA can exist as also single stranded. But whether it's a helix structure or not, that soon, in 52, 53, is revealed. And that, he proposed that this is the organism possibly, so the genome can exist in double helical structure as well as single stranded structure, like virus, it contains the DNA. Later on, other virus explored that whether it is a single stranded or a double stranded, whether it can be DNA, can be RNA, many things could be possible. And we'll also remember that this 5X174 is the first genome to be sequenced before human genome projects. In 52, there is another experiment. Possibly this is the very last experiment. After that, no scientist has experimented on the DNA genetic matter. It's also now proven and people accepted, and from 52 onwards. So Hersch's experiment, taking the same clue that in all DNA, you have phosphorus. In all protein, you have sulfur. In DNA, there is no sulfur and there is no phosphorus in protein. So he labeled the coat protein with a sulfur label protein, which is shown in red, and the DNA in the vector phase labeled with phosphorus. So he found out that the phosphorus labeled DNA is making the transformation of the vector phase, infection to the bacteria, not the phosphorus labeled protein. And this is the very thorough experiment which proves to the entire scientific community that it is not the sulfur bearing protein is the genetic material, rather it is the phosphorus bearing DNA is the genetic material. And this is the last experiment to convince that yes, DNA is the genetic material. In 53, very soon actually these people established that. And in 62, they got Nobel Prize for the discovery of the molecular structure of the DNA. And this is the paper, very one-page paper. One can go through that. You can download this paper and you can go through. Each line will be very exciting to you. And you just once you go through on DNA, the molecular structure of nucleic acid is the title of the paper and where Watson and Crick both proposed the double helical model of the structure. And this double helix, the two strands, always if one strand contains the thymine, the other will contain adenine. If one contains the guanine, the other will contain the cytosine. And this is how the two strands held together, and both strands are run anti-parallel to each other and they are always complementary. And making through the hydrogen bond, the two strands held together, and the diameter between the two strands is 2 nanometer. And that's the nanoparticle, or the nanomaterial, the DNA. That's how we'll talk later, how this DNA is explored, not only for the biological research, but also for the material research. And there is a ton, 3.4 nanometer, there'll be a single ton. At 10.5 base pair, you'll have one ton. Okay, and this always, as we discussed, adenine binds to the thymine with double hydrogen bond and guanine to cytosine with triple hydrogen bond. Okay, so the typical characteristic of the DNA you'll find all through the hydrogen bond, we call it Watson-Crick base pairing. They hybridize the two strands. Therefore, any DNA is very, you know, predictable. If one strand is given of any DNA, then you can easily write the second strand because they're complementary to each other. That's why in the NCBI or the DNA repository, you only store and you only download single strand sequence of any, you know, genetic material. You need not to put the both strand of the DNA. Second, all the DNA is B form of the DNA structures. Though there are sometimes you have Z form of, which is left-handed DNA structure. Also, we find the B form of the structure or the right-handed DNA structure, and the diameter is 2 nanometer, helical repeat is 3.4 nanometer, whether it's bacterial DNA, whether it's human DNA, whether it's elephant DNA, any DNA you take, this is the constant and the structure is very constant, 2 nanometer and helical repeat is 3.4 nanometer. In exceptional cases, you have other, you know, A structure, Z structure, other forms of structure. And DNA possesses combined structural stiffness as well as flexibility. Recent days, you have advanced toolworks, whether to synthesize or modifying DNA or replicating, you have all varieties of enzymes are available where you can play with the DNA molecule. So DNA is a very biocompatible material, making suitable for construction of multi-component nanostructure, nanodevices, and drug delivery carrier, as well as drugs itself. And after the discovery in 50, you know, the DNA is to be the central dogma. A central dogma is DNA to RNA, RNA to protein. And before that, there is only protein. Now people have not thought of DNA. Now, after this, you have major discoveries in the biological science. In 59, mechanisms in the biological synthesis of DNA, that is by Sever Okawa and Arthur Kahrenberg. Then 62, as we discussed, Francis Crick, Watson, and Wilkins structured molecular structure of DNA. Then 68, the interpretation of the genetic code, where Hole, Corona, and Nirenberg posed for that. Got Nobel Prize in 68. In 2006, Rugger Kahrenberg proposed the eukaryotic transcription, and it's very wonderful to know that Rugger Kahrenberg is the son of Arthur Kahrenberg. That means, you know, father isolated the DNA polymerase and son isolated the RNA polymerase. That's the how, you know, the polymerase family rather say. In 2009, structure and function of ribosome established by Venkatrama Ramakrishnan, Sees, and Yonath. And, you know, these were Indian-born scientists, later Nobel laureates. 2012, you know, this very important discoveries regarding DNA, the mature cells can be reprogrammed to become pluripotent. Okay, that means any cells can be reprogrammed. That's for now. And 2020, we have CRISPR-Cas technology. And this is, yes, this is the Arthur Kahrenberg, as I was telling. He has three sons, Rugger Kahrenberg, Thomas Kahrenberg, and his third son. So father isolated DNA polymerase 1, the second son Thomas Kahrenberg isolated DNA polymerase 2 and 3, the son isolated RNA polymerase, and both father and son got Nobel Prize respectively in their own field of research. And the third son, by visiting the, you know, brother and father's laboratory, he was a very good you know, molecular biologist, you know, architect engineering to design the molecular biology laboratory. And his student also got Nobel Prize. So till that, till now, in the discussion, we have the Kekule's students got Nobel Prize. You know, for, you know, the teacher-student relationship and how he produced wonderful teacher. Then Seller, the Fredrik Mischer, and Kosel, that's one group. Then you have the Korenberg and Seckmann. They got Nobel Prize as well as son, Edgar Korenberg. And here, one more thing, that how students are excited during the, like, you know, since it's a faculty development program, I'll take this opportunity to tell that, you know, Stever Okawa and Arthur Korenberg both got Nobel Prize, and we one discussed Arthur Korenberg. Now in Stever Okawa, he's the second Spanish scientist got Nobel Prize. And Stever Okawa, when he was just 7, his father died. And, you know, while it's, you know, reading in the elementary school and high school, one of the teacher, personal science teacher, he was again and again talking about the Nobel laureate from first Spain Nobel laureate, that is Santiago Ramon Cajal, who is discovered the Cajal body. Like Golgi body and Cajal body discovered in the same year, and 1906, they both got Nobel Prize. And today is the birthday of Camilo Golgi and Cajal, it is from Spain. And, you know, Stever Okawa, when he was very, young student, he was very excited that one day I will be working with Cajal. Cajal is a neuroscientist, right? Neurologist. So at the age of 18, Stever Okawa, he moved to the University of Madrid Medical School and hoped to work with Cajal. But that time Cajal retired. But imagine the aspiration of the student, Stever Okawa, to work with a Nobel laureate, you know, it was so deep aspiration to become a good scientist that he himself transformed to a Nobel laureate. And that's the Stever Okawa in the very late age also working in the lab. So this is the Stever Okawa and his inspiration, rather I will say, not maybe direct teacher, Cajal, both are Spanish scientists. And today, as you know, Camilo Golgi, today is his birthday. And always when I give a lecture, I find that what is the relevance today. And the excitement about Camilo Golgi is that he would not be that time a, you know, university professor, but he was chief medical officer, okay? And to continue his research, he set up a simple laboratory in his own, in a reformist hospital kitchen. And it was there that he started making his most notable discovery. That means science can happen anywhere, okay? It can be happen in kitchen. Of course, the science laboratory happens in the brain, actually. Once you have a, you know, thinking science, drinking science, working science, that anything, anywhere can happen science. And that's about the Camilo Golgi. And that's the message that 7th July is remembered for the Camilo Golgi. Let us, you know, take this spirit and move ahead. Okay, as you know, this Stever Okawa was a great biochemist and very inspiring teachers. All of them actually very inspiring teachers. They motivated their students. And how influential these people are. Arthur Korenberg, in his own family, must be discussing so much science that, you know, his own son taking science, not only science, he became Nobel laureate, right? So whoever in our profession, like all, we are all teachers and working in science. So the greatest motivation, discuss more science in the family itself so that our own children take up science. That is the biggest contribution to the science. Because, you know, the more we can inform them, like, medical doctors, doctor profession, or maybe advocate, you know, they discuss again and again. So scientific profession must go in that. So you must reach to the family so that next generation scientist will come from the scientific family, from the scientist family. Okay. Now let us move with that. So as you know, DNA is the genetic material, and after transcription we'll have RNA, RNA translated to protein. So this is about the biological significance of DNA, and DNA, last 100 years people are working on DNA, but last 10, in 12, 20 years, now the thought changes. DNA is not only a best biological material, rather it's the best nanomaterial. And that idea came by a chemist who is Nathan Simon in Newark University. Okay. And he's a chemist, but understand how he was describing DNA during Holiday Junction. As you know, during replication of Holiday Junction, in Holiday Junction, okay, he found that the strands share their information with the other strands. And he proposed, why not then we can have to take 4 strands rather in 1, 2, when we're taking 2 strands, they're complementary to each other. If we take 4 strands, these 4 strands will also follow the Watson-Crick base pairing, rather they'll form a branch structures. So as you know, if 2 strands will fully complementary, they'll always a linear structures, right? But if you have a 1, 2, 3, 4, or maybe many more strands can be accommodated following the Watson-Crick base pairing, we can easily prepare a branch DNA structure. And that's how he proposed this branch DNA structure. And that's how we changed our idea that DNA is not only a hereditary molecule, rather it is a hierarchical material for the nano self assembly. initially he put like this designed the monomeric structures. We have overhangs, and these overhangs can, you know, further self-assemble to form the polymeric structures. If you'll see, this is a monomer. As in the morning, Professor Alek Das sir was mentioning that, you know, there is a two ways of approaching or preparing the DNA, and usually the nanomaterials is one is bottom-up approach and another is top-down approach. So here in the DNA self-assembly, we take the bottom-up approach, and you will take monomer structure. Once designing the monomeric structure, you have overhangs, and these overhangs can be, you know, self-assembled further to form the polymeric structures. So this is the individual monomeric structure. They self-assembled from polymeric structure. This structure further self-assembled from a larger order polymeric structure, and where Semen was initially thought of, you know, putting DNA, putting protein molecule in the DNA because of DNA protein interaction. So those protein molecule is very difficult to crystallize. That can be easily crystallized. Later in the field, growth so much that we can able to prepare a larger order, you know, DNA structure, the whole world map or the smiley face, a box, anything can be prepared using the DNA structure. And such structure you can able to see in atomic force microscope, not electron microscope or any other normal microscope. And that happened in the, you know, all through these discoveries because of the 86 Nobel laureates, they proposed the electron microscope and also scanning tunneling microscope. Because of this advancement of scanning tunneling microscope and atomic microscope, this field of DNA nanotechnology, you know, reached to you know, state that many people eager to, you know, design diverse structures of the DNA. And whatever structure you see now here, started in 90s to 2010, you have enormous DNA nanostructures from various orders, from nanoscale to micrometer scale. And this is a double crossover dial, whether it's complex topology or 2D DNA crystals, 2D DNA origami. Origami is another, you know, ways to assemble the DNA. You know, you take a one single long DNA strands, maybe virus DNA, viral DNA, then you use such triple strands, maybe hundreds or maybe more than that. Then because of the Watson-Crick base pairing, then you assemble, they will form a structure. Whatever the way you design the triple strands, you get the origami structures. So DNA origami is another, you know, nanomaterials. Okay, you have a single layer DNA origami structures or multilayer origami structure or curvature, or, you know, crystals, many other structures are available. So this is how all through, you know, it started in 82 by Nadine Simon of branched DNA junctions, then synthetic DNA branched DNA junctions, DNA based computation. Like, you know, you go through, of course, I'll share the slides to you so that you can go through in free time, how this field evolved all through, okay. Then introduction of the hybridization chain reaction, DNA based working devices, many others. Then in, it continued like that. And you have 3D structures, you have self-assembled DNA crystals, you have DNA origami with complex DNA nano devices. You have, you know, which can measure the temperature inside the cell, inside the mitochondria, the pH changes inside the mitochondria, all that proposed and experimented using the DNA nano devices. So this is very unique field of DNA nanotechnology and DNA nanostructures. And these are the labs working all around the globe on DNA nanotechnology. So I just mentioned them just for the awareness, since we have a conference and faculty development program. And in India, you'll have, we work here in IMMT. We have Aijat Trivendram, Rajiv Hargis work on DNA nanotechnology, Prolay Das in IIT Patna, and Atapasi Sen works in INST. So these are the four major lab working in India on DNA nanotechnology. Earlier, Yamuna Krishnan working at NCBS Bengaluru, but now she moved to Chicago University. There he working, and he, she rather, you know, published major discoveries on DNA nanostructures and nano devices. So if you see the field of DNA nanotechnology, you have four aspects. One is the design. You have to imagine first. And you, what structure you want to design, okay? Then geometry, the matching rules, all through the Watson-Crick base pairing, but you have to set that how you can design the best, and you have to find the best sequence. Then you assemble, you understand the kinetics and thermodynamics, then you scale up, and then you functionalization if required, then interface, in whether you have a biological application, have a chemical application, whether metal applications, that's all about the structure and DNA nanotechnology. And if you go through the literature, when this paper actually excited me a lot to work on DNA field nanotechnology, And we feel the major challenge in the field of DNA nanotechnology is the high cost of the DNA because of the synthesis and because of the selection. Okay. And second is the high error rate of the self-assembly. Okay. During the self-assembly, the two strands must be perfectly self-assembled so that your yield will be better. If you have a trial and error method self-assembly, possibly we may not able to get the best structures. So I propose, being a biologist, can we, you know, use the primer sequences, which biologists, they use very often, whether it is a polymerase chain reaction, whether it is RT-PCR, whether it is a probe hybridization, all through the primer or probe, they bind very selectively to the template DNA, okay? So the binding of the primer to the template DNA is so specific that RNA polymerase or DNA polymerase can sit and run and synthesize the DNA. Therefore, those sequences can be selectively reoriented to form the DNA structure. You will see, so this is our motivation. You will see in vivo DNA synthesis, you have the primers. Whether it is a lagging strand or leading strand, you have a primer. Then this primer binding to the template is very specific, so that DNA polymerase really sits here and keep on synthesizing or adding the nucleotides to elongate the DNA strands. So this is the leading strand, this is the lagging strand or the Okazaki fragments. The same thing happen in a artificial DNA synthesis or in vitro DNA synthesis, or you can say polymerase or the thermal cycle of West, where you have a primers, the forward primer, the reverse primer, they actually exactly bind the sequence where the way it is designed. It cannot just bind anywhere. It's not a random bind at all. That's how you are using RT-PCR. You are just screening whether you have a COVID positive or negative, following the same rule for the primer. Whether once the primer bind and elongate, you are getting a positive signal. If the primer you don't find, or you know you are not infected with the SARS coronavirus, then you are negative. So this simple technique of primer binding the template is so specific. We encash this idea and you know try to design various branch DNA structures. If you see here, this sense primer and antisense primer, they bind to the template strand. So easily you get this one strand and the other complementary is another strand. So they can put together in the DNA. Okay. Now you will change the orientation from 5 prime to 3 prime or in other way, then you have another set of structures. That means from a one set of primers, you are easily getting 4 sets of DNA, and these 4 sets of DNA having same annealing temperature can be easily oriented to get the structure. For example, here you find design structures. Usually earlier we had discussed that DNA is a double strands. They are complementary to each other. But you have like the two strands, green and red, they're not complementary in the entire sequence, meaning the middle portion or you have the internal region 30 base pair, they're complementary, whereas the red and green, the last 30, 15 base pairs, they're not complementary, okay, both sides. Now, if you add the third strand, which is possibly blue, the blue is complemented to the red, not in the middle portion or the internal region, rather the external region, the 15 base pairs. That can be held together. Okay. Now the other fourth strand can be complementary in the middle region to the blue, not to the end. That means the all four strands can be designed, as I mentioned, from these primer sequences by taking the primer and the template and reorienting the direction. Then you can easily get structures. And you'll notice that all these traits of DNA sequences are derived from the gene primers like SOD, actin, or catalase. And the whole structure is a synthetic DNA, but very stable structures. That's how we'll see how stable it is. Okay. So basically, we design a 15 base pair overhangs, a 30 base pair internal binding region, and here also overhangs. This is a very standard procedure to design the DNA structure. Now, logically, if the green and red are complementary, they will bind in the middle. And red and blue, they should not bind at all because you are now mixing 4 strands. So the binding procedure or the mechanism must be very, very specific. And you will see in the figure bottom that if you say A, B, C, D, you have also E, F, G, H. Okay, we'll talk this very often in next few slides. So just I will, you know, take 1 minute here more. So A, B, C, D are 4 oligos having in the loop, that means the bending DNA, this green strand is bent here, the red strand bends here. So we add 3 times thymine. So that will not helpful for the binding, rather bending of the DNA, right? Then E, F, G, S, all the sequence same, but the loop length, the bending portion having the 5T or the 5 thymin, okay? Now, if we'll individually run the oligos, these are 66 nucleotide long or maybe 68 nucleotide long. So it will run A, B, C, D in the page, you'll find very clear single bend, okay? Now it will run A and C, they're not supposed to bind each other, then you'll have a very clear AC, they're not binding. If they're binding, you'll find a single bend, right? So if they're not binding, any ratio you are, they don't bind. Similarly, BD, they don't bind, okay? So these are the non-complementary oligos, they don't bind. Similar things will happen with A, E, G, and F, H, okay? Now we'll see, what are the different combinations? These are ABCD oligos we have taken, and the way we have explained, you can take BC, you can have AB, you can have CD, you can have AD. These are the four options, could be dioligo complex. The trioligo complex could be different structures. And these are all structures by pi by 20 nanometer size nanoparticles. Okay. Now, if I add the fourth strand, you could possibly have monomer one, monomer two. Okay. If it's too much flexible, then these strands will be self-assembled with each other so that you'll end up with monomer two. Monomer two will not allow the monomer structures to form a polymer structure. Rather, only the monomer one will enable binding further so that these overhangs will, this actin forward and this actin forward, they are complementary to each other. As a result, if one goes on, this is the monomeric structure. So these monomeric structures form a, layer of polymeric structures. And these polymeric structures can have diverse applications and very, very useful for other applications. Let me go through the sequence. So sequence are like that. You're mentioning the four nucleotides, A, T, G, C, and this is the bending DNA where we have 3T or maybe 5T, E, F, G, S, 5T, with ABCD we have 3T, and this is how the DNA sequence, this sequence derived from different genes. Now, as we understand that A and B, that's complementary in the medial portions, so it will keep on increasing A, and B is here, so B is 5, ratio is 5:0. How many is this 5:5? Here, there is just because of had some mismatch. So this is the equimolar ratio, then you are getting a bend. That means individual oligo, when you run, they migrate faster. The moment you are adding the second oligos, okay, then they assemble to form a single bend or higher order structures. Similarly, CD or AD or BC, that means those are complementary, they're all formed dioligo complexes. Similarly with EFGS, with having the loop length more, you will have the dioligo complex like this. Now let me check with all the pool. So the individual oligos, they migrate faster than the dioligo complexes, then of course the trioligo. So in the native phase, you can easily screen all these nanostructures, DNA nanostructures, nanomaterials, and very clear band. That means there is no other or the non-specific binding as because of the Watson-Crick base pairing, the structure is very predictable. And ultimately you will end up with the monomeric structure and you have a polymeric structures. Okay. And these are the desalted oligos. And if you have a purified oligos, how this line is coming here? And then you have a phase purified oligos. You will have also similar structures. That means whether it is desalted or page purified oligos, you can easily get the DNA nanomaterials or nanostructures. But one thing you notice that you are finding monomeric structure as well as polymeric structure, both in desalted and page purified oligos. Okay, you don't get pure monomer or pure polymer. So then you thought up possibly this loop length, if it is too flexible, then it is making the polymeric structure now will remove the loop length. That means there is no 5D or 3D, there is no T at all. Then we'll find only polymeric structure. And this is where you'll find there is no monomer structure, you'll find only polymeric structures. Okay. And this is the effect of loop length. You'll have A, B, C, D, as we mentioned, this is the monomeric structure, polymeric structure with 3T. That means the loop length is 3T. And in the 5D, so their molecular weight is little more. That is the only difference. Otherwise, the assembly, whether you are taking 3T loop or 5T loop, all three is same. And in both, you have the monomer structure. And here you'll find the ABCD, you have only one band. and possibly here you have two bands. Then why, you know, there is two bands? Then again we ask, what is the meaning? The two bands means very distinct structure. How to characterize the two bands? Here, we further experimented that if you take A, B, C, D, you are getting only one band. That means the monomer structure is very clear and you're forming a polymer structure. And E, F, G, H, you are getting very, very sharp two bands. And these two bands mentioning that possibly you have monomer 1 as well as monomer 2. And this monomer 2 comes only because of the flexibility. And at the same time, there's a chance that you are forming monomer 1. Okay. Now, you have whether it is same or not, and that's the region for the loop length or not, you'll find we have made another structure that is called AFGD. That means the internal two oligos are same 5T, and the external AD oligos, they are the 3T. And the external sequence are responsible for this monomer and monomer 2, not the internal structure or the sequence. Therefore, in AFGD, the AD having 3T, there is only one band. The upper band is very faint, or there is no band at all. Okay, but when then we reversed, whether it is because of that, then we'll end up with only monomer 2. Okay, then we changed EBCH. That means E and H, the overhangs or external sequences having 5T, and BC having the 3T. Then the lower band is vanished and the upper band remains. Okay, so in that combination you'll find clearly there is only two structures, monomer 1 and monomer 2 is possible, and you have also polymeric structures. So the idea is that possibly you are getting AB and CD, then AB, CD, they bind to form monomer 2. Or here the AB and CD is like this, then you have formed monomer 1. And when there is no loop length or the no T, then we are finding a polymeric structure. Okay. Now this is how the structure, as we mentioned, so this actin 2 are the overends where they self-assemble to the polymeric structure. If you have a 3T, okay, you have more of the monomer 1. If you have 5T, you have monomer and polymer 50-50%. If you have no T, then you end up only polymeric structure, there is no monomer structure. Okay, so how did the stability of the structures, DNA nanostructures? And as we discussed, that all four oligos, they have to bind to equimolar ratio 1:1:1:1. Therefore, you'll get the most stable structure. So this is how we put the trioligo complex BCD 1:1:1, you have a clear band. Then slowly we're increasing the concentration of oligo A. Then you'll find the trioligo concentration slowly vanished and the monomer structure slowly appear. And while the ratio is 1:1:1:1, then you'll find monomer and polymer structure. This is both possible with 3T loop and 5T loop. Okay. And just to increase, if I will increase the oligo concentration 2 molar, molar ratio of 2 of 1 oligos, then I find the unused oligos in the bottom D. And if I keep on increasing the A, then I'll find a complex of AD. That means these oligos, they are very selective. They bind each other with equimolar concentration. And with equimolar concentration, your yield is very good. There is no non-specific product. Because of the non-specific product, you can claim that this method of self-assembly are error-free. Okay. And this structure are very stable. We find the 120 days old samples. They are showing the similar pattern of the bands as native or the natural or the, quick synthesis or the NAV synthesis. And in the different time interval also, you find the monomeric to polymeric structure are very intact. Therefore, DNA is very, very stable structures, the nanostructures particularly, and you can have different applications. Then we further can have a simple structures, Y-shaped structures by taking the same. Yes, we can design the three oligos and you possibly get a structure like this. You have the three oligos, A, B, C, you can name. If you have any dioligo complex, the structure will be like this. Then you add the third oligo, then the structure will form like this. This Y-shaped structure can further assemble to form a, double Y-shaped structure. Then imagine this structure is further assembled to form a, benzene-like structure. Then further a honeycomb structure. This honeycomb structure further assembled to a bigger higher order structure. And this higher order structure will find a leaf-like structure of this, maybe 1 micrometer long. That means if this is the loop length, T, and this loop length helps in the bending, And if you'll simply taking few sequences of the DNA, you are getting a bigger structure, and these structures are very, very stable structure. And you can have many applications. This is how they hybridize, and all these hybridization because of the Watson-Crick pairing or hydrogen bonding. Let me check that how they are binding. So these are the individual oligos. AB means two oligo, right? And these are different ratio. And you find in 1:1 ratio that have a clear band. And if you add little more or little less of other oligos, you have unused oligos in the bottom. That means always all these oligos are designed in a manner they bind very specifically, and you are getting only one specific structure, that is the dioligo complex. And this dioligo complex, YA means Y-shaped structure, oligo A, AB means two oligos, okay? ABC means three oligos. When you are taking three oligos, you find this monomer structure is more and double Y-shaped structure is less. But all through in the solution-based self-assembly, you don't get polymer structure. Like earlier, you get a polymer structure, but here you do not get a polymer structure. That means this structure not allowing the structure to further self-assemble in solution. That means in solution, this structure are not stable. Then we characterize how to do a better self-assembly so that we'll get the lip-like hybrid structure. And this also, we tried once more, these are the individual oligos, and you have dioligo structures, you have trioligo structures, you have dimer structures, but you don't get a polymer structures, okay? And let me further, and we tried whether a two-step assembly will be better, then this is the, single-step assembly, the polymer, then the monomer and polymer is a single step. You take all three oligos at a time, then you self-assemble. But when you have a two-step self-assembly, you first dioligo complex, then you add the third oligos in different combinations. These are the different combinations. But you find, the two-step assembly also making the same sense. You have monomer structure is very intense, and double Y-shaped structure is very less. But no way you are getting a polymer structures. Okay, here both with the 3T or the 3T loop with the 5T loop, we get the same. So that means the quick assembly process and two-step process solution-based self-assembly not allowing these structures for the self-assembly. These are the mechanism, how it happens. Like earlier we mentioned, this is the dioligo complex we met. Then slowly we titrated with the third oligos, possibly here it is YC, and increasing the concentration of the YC, then your dioligo concentration goes off, that means down, disappear. Then slowly you appear the trioligo complex or the Y-shaped monomer structures, and slowly the Y-shaped monomer structure form a double Y-shaped structures. All through it is same, but if you have a ratio of 1:2 higher order, then you have unused oligos. Then what do you do? You took the structures and put on the aluminum foil surface. Okay. And you just notice that aluminum helps in self-assembly. So in the aluminum foil, what happened? Well, the structure which is not, we're not getting in the solution, they appear to assemble, and we're getting wonderful Y-shaped, the leaf-like structures in the whole entire surface of the aluminum foil. We're so excited, and we measured that is almost like 1/2 micron structure. That's been really the leaf-like structure of branched DNA, and that can be easily. So first we thought that whether buffers are only deposited on like this and we're getting structures. No. If you see the only buffer, the surface looks like this, only aluminum foil surface like this. But when you're taking the DNA solution and you are getting structure like this, that means these are all DNA self-assembly structures. Possibly proposed how the nucleus is set. So this honeycomb-like structure then slowly started assembling, and your nucleus point, then slowly they start expanding, and this through process of expansion, then the leaf-like structure forms. And this leaf-like structure, once in aluminum foil form, then we characterize in the page. Now you see it is the earlier quick assembly procedure where you are finding the monomer structure and double Y-shaped structure. Here there is no polymer structure. But here you will find these polymer structure are appearing in the self-assembly on the surface of aluminum foil. That means the solid state self-assembly making the assembled product a larger order than the solution-based structure. Further, in the solution-based structure, the overall bigger structure may not be stable, but any surface, if you have a surface bottle with the cations, they help in self-assembling of the DNA structure so that you're finding a polymer structure. And this is how in different concentration of oligos, the double Y-shaped structure is increasing. So let us ask the, then we ask the question whether in the polymeric structure is okay, they are not stable in solution, and in any biological applications, these monomeric structures need to be very well prepared and we should be devoid of the polymeric structure, because only the monomeric structure can be applicable for the biological systems. That means the proposed monomeric structure was earlier actin and actin, they are complementary. Okay. So they are binding to form polymeric structure. Then what we did, we redesigned the structure so that this another gene sequence is there. This gene sequence is not complemented to the actin. As a result, you find only monomeric structures. There is no complement. And this homogeneous monomeric structure will be very, very useful. And we expect now there should not be any polymeric structure. We'll find only monomeric structure. So from now we switch from polymeric to monomeric behavior, how the polymeric structure changes to monomeric structure by simple changing the nucleotide sequence, all other structures remain constant. And we'll see earlier the A, B, C, D, we we thoroughly checked that we're finding a monomeric structure and they assemble to form a polymeric structure, A, B, C, D polymeric structures. Now this A oligo, the green one, which was earlier actin sequence was there, now it changed to G3PDS and another sequence, and this sequence is not complemented to the actin. As a result, this IBCD oligo, BCD remains constant, only A changes to I, then you know you are thus polymeric structures entirely disappeared and you are getting only monomeric structures, and these monomeric structures are very homogeneous, and these are 5 by 20 nanometer size, that means 5 meter width and diameter, you know, length is 20 nanometer. This can be easily applicable to biological science research, and just to test how it will be helpful, and it contains 4 overhangs. So can these overhangs be antisense molecule? Can these overhangs carry the microRNA? Can these overhangs carry the siRNA? Can these microRNA, can these overhangs carry the anti-microRNA? So these are the questions to be solved, okay? And now this is the structure. Just to check before that, we added the complementary oligos, whether they are very specific binding or not. Just, this is the very basic of the application. We'll go further into that. So let us check with this figure. In the first lane, you have only a monomeric structure, okay, very clear monomeric structure, there is no unused product. Now in the second lane, we added the non-complementary oligo, which is not supposed to bind, and the migration is constant. The extra oligos, which is not complementary, is coming here in the bottom, unused oligos, okay. In the third, you have complementary oligos, okay, we have added the complementary oligos to strand A, then it is, of course, it's binding, then there is a shift. If there is a binding, there is a molecular weight is increasing. If the molecular weight is increasing, then you have a shifting. That shifting shows, and there is no unused oligo. That means these structures can be easily used for the nucleic acid-based therapeutics. Okay. Then you have, in presence of non-complementary oligos, we have added the oligos. Yes. Yes, we have a shift, and the unused oligos is here coming. Okay. Then we added the other non-complementary oligos, and in presence of 10 different non-complementary oligos. That means when we're thinking of putting these structures for nanotherapeutics inside the cell, you have thousands of different mRNAs, microRNAs, and other sequence, nucleotide sequence, that should not interfere in the binding. Therefore, we added 10 different non-complementary oligos, and we checked that, yes, the binding is remain intact, and there is a shifting in the band, that means molecular weight is increasing because of the complementary binding. And at the same time, you have all these non-complementary oligos in the bottom as unused oligos, okay? Then similarly, in the different combination, you can easily find out that while you have two complementary oligos, oligo 1 and 2, the binding, there is a super shifting, and you have a single, there is a less shifting. That means these oligos can easily accommodate 4 different, you know, sequence or antisense oligos or mirror or anti-mirror siRNA, and can be easily delivered as therapeutics. And one other important thing, both this polymeric structure and monomeric structure are showing B-type DNA. As we discussed earlier, these are all right-handed DNA. Whether it is a linear or branched DNA doesn't matter, because they are following Bowers-centric base pairing. They have a helicity, and that all the monomeric as well as the polymeric structures, they are the B-type of DNA, and that shows from the circular dichroism spectroscopy, where you find a positive peak at 280 nanometer and a negative band at 250 nanometer. That shows the B type of DNA. Okay. And the TM value, or the melting temperature of the branched DNA, polymeric DNA is more than the monomeric DNA because of the higher order structure. Okay. Now, if you see the RNA-based, as we are discussing of the RNA therapeutics or the nucleic acid-based therapeutics, if you go on the papers, you'll find in RNA studies, particularly 55,000 publications per year, it happens like that. Okay. In the microRNA, particularly 15,000 papers. And RNA or RNA therapeutics diagnostics, you'll have enough papers, maybe 16,000 per year. And you have microRNA diagnostic, 4,000. That means the field of nucleic acid research, particularly the RNA, is more. Okay. Now, these our branch DNA structures, the DNA nanostructures, DNA nanomaterials can have an application here. And in 2006, after Pyre and Melu discovered the RNA interference, the antisense RNA. Okay. Then this through Dicer mechanism, we find that these microRNA are the major contributor that controlling for the gene expression. And it was identified that particularly in cancer, 34% of the microRNA contribute to the disease onset, and other diseases are also controlled by the microRNAs. Not only that, one very exciting information you get, many of the time in the disease conditions, the microRNA are off-regulated. MicroRNA are short oligonucleotides, 18 to 24 nucleotides, and these are off-regulated during disease conditions. So there must be means to down-regulate the microRNA, and these are all comes under nucleic acid therapeutics, and very less microRNA, though they are down-regulated. You can also, think for the, off-regulating those microRNA. And the first microRNA, which is hepatitis C virus, come in phase 3 clinical trial in 2007. That means there is a possibility that this microRNA can be a target by nucleic acid therapeutics, because only nucleic acid therapeutics are very selective and sequence specific to the and target molecule. No other molecules can be very specific to the RNA. Even in millions of microRNA, this best pairing or the worst best pairing is so selective, they will bind only to the microRNA or specific DNA. And as we discussed, these microRNA, which is very short oligonucleotides, they control almost 60% of the protein coding genes controlled by the microRNA. Not only that, it's now widely accepted that each microRNA, one individual microRNA, can control many mRNAs. That means many genes are controlled by a single microRNAs, and that's therapeutic is important. And at the same time, a single mRNA is controlled or regulated by multiple microRNAs. That means if we apply single antisense oligonucleotides, it will not solve the problem. If any gene to be targeted or regulated, that means multiple microRNAs to be targeted or multiple anti-microRNA could be, applied, so they will bind to the, microRNAs. So can we downregulate the overexpressing microRNAs? Those are oncogenic microRNA in cancer, so that you can upregulate the tumor suppressor proteins. So keeping that in questions, you will take the four oligos. Then in the overhangs, what we did now, these overhangs are now redesigned to take up this anti-microRNA. Why this 27A, 96, and 182? These three microRNA, they regulate the expression of FOXO1. FOXO1A is a tumor suppressor protein, which is downregulated in cancer, particularly in breast cancer. Okay. And this gene is known to be regulated by these three microRNAs. And these three microRNA are upregulated in breast cancer. So we thought of using this branch DNA structure, having the anti-mer sequence of 27A, 96. Why two doses of 27A? Because the 27A level of microRNA is more, almost double as compared to the 96 and 182. Thus, we thought that this branch DNA structure can carry two doses of 27A and single dose of anti-mer microRNA 96 and 182. If this will be transfected to the breast cancer cell lines, then inside the cell, they will titrate, they will complementary bind to the microRNA very specifically to the 27A and 96-182. As a result, these microRNA 27 and 96-182, they will not able to bind to the mRNA of the FOXO1A. As a result, FOXO1A mRNA will be free to translate to the protein level will be more. Okay. Keeping that in mind, we design various structures that 26 scaffold, that means control branch DNA. This would not bind anywhere. 27A, only containing 27A, 96, 182, and branch DNA mix. We call this structure the branch DNA mix. If it is 27A, then all four overhangs will contain 27A. Okay. So all other structures are very specific to one particular microRNA, whereas branch dynamics is contains all three microRNA in the overhangs. Okay. And this is the assembled product having taking the different anti-microRNA sequence in the branch DNA. Yes, they're well assembled and getting a clear monomeric structure. Before transfecting to the cell lines, we checked whether this branch DNA containing anti-microRNA selectively binds to their the complementary microRNA or not. Yes, then we run a gel, it's a scaffold control DNA, then different branch DNA 27, 96 and 182, and it's a mix. Then when we incubated with the different microRNA, with the scaffold, we have three microRNA. They don't bind because they're not complementary and they're not supposed to bind. But with the branch DNA 27A and with mid 27A, where the branch DNA 96 with mid 96, since they're complementary, you'll find a very clear shift in the band. That means they're able to bind to the specific microRNA. Thus can be applied to the cell lines. But before that, again, we use the serum stability assay, whether they are stable or not. Yes. So in the serum stability assay, you'll find anti-mir branch DNA that very stable up to 48 hours, whether it is 27A, 96, 182 or branch DNA mix. All these branch DNA structures are very stable up to 48 hours. And we took the control. Those are not with branch DNA. They are only single anti-mir. So when you took the anti-mir, anti-mir 27A, 182 or 96, they are hardly stable up to 12 hours or maximum 24 hours. So they disappear with time. Okay, that means individual antisense oligonucleotides or anti-mirs are not stable as compared to the branch DNA mix. You will see this figure, you clearly understand that in 48 hours, still 50% of the branch DNA carrying anti-microRNA are very stable, whereas only anti-microRNAs, those are taken for the expression study, those are maybe 12 hours or maximum 20 hours, or 24 hours, they're almost like not all, only 10% is remaining of 48 hours. That means the branch DNA stabilizes the therapeutics molecule anti-mir, and this nanostructure nanomaterial having 5 by 20 nanometer scale structures can be useful as a therapeutics applications. Further, this structure we checked for the DNA's activity. When you check that ABC means two oligos, and when it's dioligo complex, they are less, stable in presence of DNAs. When it is trioligo complex, the stability still increase, but when it's a, ABCD or the IBCD or the monomer structures, they're very stable in presence of DNA activity. As you know, DNAs, they bind, and the linear DNA, they cut the DNA, but it's the branch nature of the DNA. Relatively, the branch DNA are more stable than the linear DNA. They're also, what is the response to the metal ions? Because inside the cell, you'll have metal ions also. So in the sodium and potassium, which is very rich in our biological system, they're very stable up to 500 millimolar concentration of sodium and potassium. So these structures won't be affected by the metal ions. But in magnesium, 100 millimolar is good, not 500 millimolar. And in presence of zinc, these complex, they assemble further. They rather aggregate. Okay. And this such concentration of the zinc, lanthanum, cerium, this cannot be used for applications. But people capitalize this phenomenon of metal ion binding to the branch DNA. Since they bind or agglomerate, they can be easily transfected using metal ions. And particularly, people have used the zinc as a delivery agent for the branch DNA structures. Whether these molecules are safe to the cell or not, okay, whether they bind to the other protein molecules, we tested that the branch DNA scramble or branch DNA mix, when interacted with the protein bovine liver catalase, one protein which enzyme degrades the hydrogen peroxide to water and oxygen, we find yes, this branch DNA structure, they interact with the proteins. Okay, these are in cellulo in vitro biophysical experiment, and the fluorescence is decreasing. That means the branch DNA binding to the protein. If they're binding, then whether the activity is sensed or not, then we measure the activity of bovine liver catalase. It's very easy to do that experiment with the activity assay, and we find in 1 hour incubation or in 24 hour incubation, the activity is not sensed in presence of branch DNA, okay, or even branch DNA mix. Rather, in branch DNA mix, the activity of the BLC is stabilized, and toward the highest concentration will be more, a bit more activity than this, or maybe significant rather. So therefore, the branch DNA may be interacting with the protein inside the cell, or biophysically we have seen yet, but it is not influencing the activity. That is very important for a biomaterial which is applied to the cell. This should not interfere the activity or the biochemical activity of the enzymes, and then only it can be safe for other applications. Now we have transfected this branch DNA nanostructure, 25 nanomolar, to the MCF7 cell lines, the breast cancer cell lines. Then we have also controlled Antimer 100 nanomolar. Whether with respect to the Antimer, as we have seen in the serum stability assay, the branch DNA carrying the Antimer are more stable than the Antimer oligonucleotides only. Then we checked, and we are expecting these branch DNA will go and bind to the Mer, so that microRNA expression of 27, 96, and 182 should be down. So we have taken the control, and with the Antimer application, which is a very conventional method of binding to the microRNA, yes, they are really decreasing all through, no doubt. But in presence of branch DNA, you'll find there is a significant decrease in the microRNA. That means the branch DNA carrying the Antimer structures are, significantly titrating or down-regulating the microRNA 27, 186, and 182. Thus, once the concentration of the oncogenic microRNA or the cancer-causing microRNA are down, then possibly we have a safe site to the cancer, and the microRNA binding mRNA, which is the FOXO1 mRNA, is now free, and that can be translated further to protein. And we've seen the Western blotting of the FOXO1 expression, and we'll find with respect to the control, FOXO1 expression is more all through. This is the FOXO1 result. You'll find with respect to the alpha tubulin, in presence of branch DNA, this expression of FOXO1 expression is more. Therefore, we can easily conclude that the branch DNA nanomaterials can carry the therapeutics molecules itself as a drug, as well as carrier for the regulating the microRNA expression. FOXO1 being a major transcription factor, we have also checked whether the downstream gene expression is really upregulated or not. So this FOXO3 expression also, upregulated by the Antimer branch DNA, beta catenin, E-cadherin, N-cadherin, P21, and P27. So all these gene expression elevated, which shows that certainly it has, applications. And the branch DNA Antimer structures regulating the FOXO1 expression. To further add these structures, so these structures now can be applicable to other gene expression. So we checked another particular gene that is called SOMF1. SOMF1 is a, expression is very low during tumor, that is a sulfidase gene. So when you design that, there is no microRNA known to regulate the SOMF1, but we predict that possibly this microRNA regulated because those microRNA sites are there. So we design another structure regulating the SOMF1 expression. There we find in designing also, we took the ABCD oligos and we have a scramble sequence. And designing the Antimer branch DNA, we took Antimer 148. And this Antimer 148, 106, and 128, these three and microRNA are possibly regulating the SOMF1 expression. And by incubating this branch DNA mix with the particular Mer 106, 128, and 148, you'll find there is a shifting. That means it can able to bind and regulate. So when you transfect this branch DNA scramble 106, 128, or 148, and mix, you'll find there is a stability of this branch DNA structure inside the cell. Because of the fluorescence, we find the structure quite stable, and the SOMF1 expression, which were supposed to more in Antimer branch DNA structure, what we find very, very less. That means probably the SOMF1 expression is not directly controlled by this anti-microRNA branch DNA. Maybe some repressor protein, which is there, that is regulated by this anti-microRNA 106, 121, 180. As a result, SOMF1 expression is down both in HCK and MCF7 cell lines. So thus, we can conclude that oligonucleotides derived from the eukaryotic genome, as we mentioned, that how from different genes primers can be reoriented to get the structure from the through bottom-up self-assembly, are able to create stable and biocompatible branch DNA nanometers. This is the first message from our work, that yes, directly the eukaryotic genomic sequences, particularly the primer sequences, can be easily explored to create or design branch DNA structures. Then the specific hybridization, that's called error-free hybridization rather, enable the high yield of branch DNA that is observed through PEDS. Then you have higher serum stability of the self-assembled branch DNA structure than conventional antisense oligonucleotides. So it is not now necessary that we'll go through the conventional method of individual oligonucleotides. Rather, we can prefer the branch DNA structure, which is self-stable and stabilize the therapeutic molecule, particularly the antisense or siRNA or microRNA or anti-microRNA for the stable structures. The binding of branch DNA with enzyme, it's, yes, it is binding, but the activity is unchanged. That means they're safe, they're biocompatible. Therefore, application of the anti-mir branch DNA structure for regulating oncogenic microRNA, of course, in other microRNA as well. So since we have done with cancer, we are telling you oncogenic microRNA it can regulate, but other microRNAs can also be regulated using anti-mir branch DNA model type. So, and thirdly, the branch DNA, they can carry the multiple target microRNAs. So in our structure, we have 4 overrings. The structure can be reoriented to design the other branch DNA structure, can carry 6, 8, even many multiple microRNAs. And at a time, we can deliver multiple microRNAs to the same cell line. So in the delivery, if structure is delivered, means all microRNA are delivered, or all anti-microRNA are delivered. So these are the advantages of DNA nanostructures. So we'll be very happy. Those are interested for taking such field together, and even people use gold nanoparticle with DNA nanostructures for delivery, for delivering the branch DNA structures. So nanoparticle research with DNA nanomaterials has a great future ahead, and possibly in the down the line we'll see this DNA nanotherapeutics in application in applied in personalized medicine. So this I acknowledge all my students, those they contribute for the work. So we have 3 areas of research, particularly the one we presented, which is the people they work behind that. And second group, they work on metal DNA interaction study. And the third, they work on computational work on protein metal and DNA metal interactions. So thank you all. I'm really very happy that the best introduction to me is that I'm the alumnus of Utkal University, and this is a chance that I interacted with the faculties, teachers, and they will carry forward for the field of DNA nanotechnology. So again, I am thankful to the organizing committee members for giving this wonderful opportunity to interact. Now,